a limited edition of around 2 million. No? Well, let me give you a clue. It's the Capri.
Is a car liked and loathed with equal passion. Unsurprisingly, the 10,000-strong Capri Club International are pretty keen. Why?
Because it's a good-looking car, and it goes well.
They're easy to work on and fun to drive.
It's an individual car. It's got a character.
They're so easy and cheap to maintain.
And no matter where you go, people look at you and say, wow, that's nice. It's happened to me quite a few times with my car.
Of course, the Capri's strongest feature was that it was all things to all men. Of course, the Capri's weakest feature was that it was all things to all men. Because 25 years ago, Ford were marketing the Capri in much the same way they're punting out the Probe today. You dish out a few high-performance versions to easily excitable journalists, and as a consequence, you sell lots and lots of rather more ordinary cars to people who live in the real world. One of these crisp and crunchy 150 horsepower V6 RS3100s that left the showroom, there would have been a whole herd of soft and squidgy 70 horsepower four-cylinder 1.3s. Unlike the Escort Mexico or Lotus Cortina, the Capri was never some souped-up saloon. And if yours was one of the less well-endowed examples, well, there was plenty of padding available to provide you with more front than Blackpool. You see, the thing about style is that you've either very obviously got it or you just haven't got it. And it seems that the Capri has always been the perfect vehicle for those wishing to make that crucial fashion statement. It's funny, isn't it? In the good old US of A, the notion of testosterone-rich teenagers getting their hands on cheap, fast cars and behaving badly on a Saturday night has passed into popular folklore. Let's face it, Bruce Springsteen's based his entire career on it. But over here, well, it's a bit naff, really, isn't it? And has landed the Capri with an unfortunate medallion man image that television has done nothing to contradict.
I've always wanted to do that, and now I have. The Mark III was Ford's attempt to give the Capri's tarnished image a shiny new lick of paint, but it didn't fool anybody. And if you were a hard-drinking, tough-talking TV detective with a penchant for leather coats and handbrake turns, then this was the only car to be seen doing it in.
Capri was right from the word go, and they should have left well alone. But Ford just couldn't resist tailoring it for expensive tastes when what it was always best at were cheap thrills.
Whatever you might think of the bewildering variations on the Capri theme, you can't deny that this was a distinctive car. A Capri always looked like a Capri, and it was enthusiasm from within these aisles that kept it going in the twilight of its 18-year production run. But then came the XR3, an artificially enhanced interloper in my estimation, and the rest is history. Given the choice between a genuine sports coupe and a trumped-up Escort, I know which one I'd go for every time.
But can we, in all honesty, call the Capri a classic? Yeah, I think we can. And certainly the V6 engined examples are far more deserving of that accolade than any number of drafty, underpowered British sports cars, fragile, effete Italian jobs, or austere, air-cooled Central European peasant wagons. Mind you, I would say that. I've got one.